got a beautiful day out there. After yesterday teasing us with that wind and the rain and everything, I thought it was going to be another one of these snowy weekends. Beautiful day through the week, but then the weekend we get snow to threaten our weekend. Announcement. next Sunday, we will be upstairs. It's Palm Sunday, and it's also going to be a communion Sunday. So we'll be upstairs celebrating communion, Lord's Supper, and Palm Sunday. Our Christian education series will continue this week. This week will be at Cabin at 3 o'clock. We are going to watch the videos today, Name and Open, if we have the time to get that third one in. I know we say every time, you know, if we can get the third one in, we never do get the third one in. The discussion just gets so advanced and sometimes off topic, but it's a worthwhile discussion we had you have. So come on out for that one. As I say, Cabin, Wednesday at 3 o'clock.
After Lenten lunch.
After Lenten lunch, yeah. And the Lenten lunch is at Cabin this week, 12 o'clock. The guest speaker is Bob Rowe from Freedom Syrup. Or Syrup Freedom?
Freedom Syrup.
Freedom Syrup, yeah, okay. And he'll be talking, and he's well known in the area. So, and all donations we make that day will be going to Freedom Syrup as well.
Purchase is available.
And you can buy syrup as well. Yeah. Get some fresh maple syrup. We have several concerts coming up. The Scott Woods concert, April 28th. That's the first one. Tickets. We do have tickets now. I have tickets. Alan has tickets. Does Don have tickets? Connie has tickets? The office has tickets? Everyone's got tickets. So we just need to sell them. So if you want a ticket for that, contact any one of us and we'll get you a ticket. It's $45 a ticket. And that will be a good evening, April 28th. And Huron Song is coming to us again for their spring concert. That'll be on June 20th. So we got a busy schedule coming up for concerts. And then in the fall, October 22nd, we have Roy LeBlanc, our Elvis tribute. And he also does some other ones. Roy Orbison, and a couple of other really good artists. So that is, he does a really good show, I know that. And that's what I have. Is there anything else we need to share with each other this morning before we get going? No other news, no other, any baptism, anniversaries or birthdays this past week or the week to come? You know, we will find out. Even if it's 2 weeks later, we'll find out. We will sing happy birthday to you. You can run, but you can't hide. Okay, well, we'll begin by our candle liturgy, our Lenten candle liturgy. When we arrived this morning, we entered into the normal hustle and bustle of a church on a Sunday morning. Friends greeting each other, people bringing their energy and enthusiasm. But now that we're sitting together, I invite you, close your eyes. Consider the word sanctuary. A sanctuary is a place set aside for sacred things, a place of refuge and protection. This room is a sanctuary. The season of Lent is a kind of sanctuary extended through time. And one of the things Lent teaches us is that each and every one of you is a sanctuary. There is inside of you a place for sacred things, a place where God abides. As we extinguish this light, we acknowledge the darkness and the pain of war and oppression in the world. And we're going to sing verses 1 to 5 of throughout these Lenten days and nights. 1 to 5.
Throughout these Lenten days and nights, we turn to walk the inward way. We're meeting Christ, our guide and light. We live in hope till Easter Day. Greater power. rising hour. We bear the silence, cross, and pain of human burdens, human strife, while sisters, brothers help sustain our courage till the feast of life.
Let us pray together. Loving God, we open our hearts to you. We invite you into the innermost being, only to find you already there. Strengthen us in our quiet places, and lead us to the work of justice and peace. Amen. And our song of centering is, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. All who believe in me, although they die, yet they shall live. Choose this day whom you will serve.
God has set before us life and death, praising the light or cursing the darkness, loving others or cultivating selfish indifference.
Morning, blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from. From heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the red garden, sprung in completeness where his feet. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day. First morning, blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world.
Let us continue in prayer. Compassionate God, the wind of your spirit is the very sign of life for all who long for you. One breath from you and we are rescued from the arid valley of dry bones, given muscles and sinews and joy with which to praise you. Filled with the holy hope you grant to all your faithful children, let our whole lives be filled with the life breath of the Spirit that is lain dormant and may burst into bloom, and what looks to us like to be death may be revealed as but sleep before the emergence of new life. Amen. And a prayer, confession, and assurance. God has set before us life and death. The choice is ours. Let us acknowledge the misuse of our liberty of choice. Let us pray. Let us ask to be forgiven for the times when we have chosen badly, opting for the easy way of habits and social convention, rather than the higher and harder ways of Christ.
Let us confess that sometimes our choices have been made from selfish, the little concern of those around us, even those who love us dearly.
Let us ask to be forgiven for putting off decisions, for dithering and avoiding choices until the opportunity has gone by.
Let us confess that we have at times made outwardly good decisions for the wrong reasons, driven by sordid motives.
Holy God, Savior and Friend, we thank you that long before we faced up to ourselves and frame our confessions, your mercy in Christ Jesus is here, waiting for us. We rest our mortal lives in your immortal life, allowing your grace, mercy, and peace to cleanse, refresh, and straighten us. Breathe into our humanity, loving God, that we may live fully.
Please breathe your spirit into our brains, that our decisions may be pure in our lives.
Breathe your spirit on our lips, that our speech may witness to life and light and holy joy.
Breathe your spirit on our hands, that in your business may serve you before our eyes.
Breathe your spirit on our feet, that we may tread this earth with gentleness and respect. Through Christ Jesus, our Savior.
Amen.
My sisters and brothers, it is written, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set us free from the law of sin and death. You'd better believe it, my friends. You are forgiven and liberated. Live as a free and forgiven people. Amen. And we're going to try another song for the beauty of the earth.
Oh,
hungry and you want a snack or something there just to hold you through, you know, what are some of your favorite foods that you want to just snack on?
Grapes.
Grapes, yeah, that's healthy. You know what my favorite one is? Kraft dinner. I fell in love with that in 78 when I started university. I'll tell you, I still like it today. This will hold me over. Why don't we just share some right now, okay? We'll make it up here. That don't look like Kraft dinner I normally make. It's kind of dried out. What's wrong with it?
Boiling water.
Boiling water. Ah, you gotta cook it, do ya? You gotta prepare it. I see. Well, you know, just looking at this macaroni dried all like that kind of reminds me about the reading we're gonna read in the story of Ezekiel. Ezekiel is plopped down in this middle of this valley, and there's dry bones everywhere. Kind of like this dried out macaroni. Dried up, just laying there. Now, these old bones there are just laying around. And God asks Ezekiel, can these bones come to life? And Ezekiel says, if you will it, God, it can happen. So God tells Ezekiel to speak the words to the bones. And the bones start to all come together. Muscles, sinews form, skin forms on the bones. And eventually, they all come back and they're all laying there, full bodies. But there's no breath in them yet. So God asks, can these bodies breathe? And Ezekiel says, yes, if you command it, Lord. And God gives Ezekiel the word, the power to say, breath enter you. And the Holy Spirit enters these bodies and they come to life. Like this macaroni, it looks dried and useless now. But we know that once we cook it, it is a very tasty meal. With those bodies there, God brought them back to life. We go through life so many times, hardships can hit us. Hard times can come out of nowhere. We don't know what's going on. It's like that valley. The valley was representing the people of Israel. And there was no hope for the people. Everything seemed hopeless and lost. They'd been defeated, conquered by the Babylonians. They're in exile. They were totally destroyed, broken as a people. The bones were representing the hopelessness of the people of Israel. But God comes along and says, listen, there is hope for you all. He brings them back to life just to prove that he can do this. He can bring life. He can bring hope to the most hopeless situations. God can take the worst things that happen in their life and give us hope again. Hope to go on. Take the worst situations and give us hope again. There are many things that can happen to us in our lives that knock us down and we can feel totally lost. It may take time. It may be hard to believe that those bones can actually come back to life. When everything in our world is falling apart, it is our faith in God that sometimes can get us through those hardships, get us through those trials in life. God can bring us through those hard times. And in the end, we can find happiness once again. Amen. Let's close this with a short prayer. Loving God, we thank you for your Spirit, which gives life to us and to all. For your Son, Jesus, who died and rose again, so that we can live forever. We thank you that you are always with us, even through the worst times in our lives, the times of trial. And we know that with you by our side, we can always come through this and find happiness at the end. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I have to cook that up later now.
Dust and ashes, church of praise, mark our failures and our falling. Holy Spirit, come, walk with us tomorrow. Take us
Loving God, you are our resurrection and our life. Register amongst us those who commit themselves to the faith that we have already crossed over from defeat to victory, from death to life. Let us live with good humor among the cynics who mask their own despair with witty sarcasm. Let us celebrate the heaven that has already come amongst us and share its fruits with one another. For your love's sake, amen. Our first scripture reading comes from the prophet Ezekiel. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth amongst them. I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. God asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said, "Sovereign Lord, you alone know." Then God said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to the bones. I will make breath enter you and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you, cover you with skin. I will put my breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know I am the Lord." So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a noise, a rattling sound. And the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them. But there was no breath in them. And then he said to me, "Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come, breath, from the four winds, and breathe into these slain, that they may live." So I prophesied as God commanded, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then God said to me, "Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say our bones are dried up, and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy to them and say, this is what the sovereign Lord says. My people, I am going to open the graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring them up from them. I will put my spirit in you and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord God, has spoken. I have done it, declares the Lord." These are the words of the Lord. And our gospel reading today comes from the gospel according to John. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." When he heard this, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, that God's Son may be glorified through it." Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was for two more days. Then he said to his disciples, "Let us go back to Judea." "But Rabbi," they said, "a short while ago the Jews there tried to stone you, and yet you are going back?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of day? Anyone who walks in daytime will not stumble, for they see this world's light. When a person walks at night, that is when they stumble, for they have no light." After he said this, he went on to tell them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going to wake him up." The disciples replied, "Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better." Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. So he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him." Then Thomas said to the rest of the disciples, "Let us go also, that we may die with him." On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Mary and Martha to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard this, that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe in this?" "Yes, Lord," she replies. "I believe you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into the world." After she said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here," she said, "and is asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house, comforting her, noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn her brother. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said to him, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind kept this man from dying?" Jesus once more, deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been in there 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." And when he had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary had seen what Jesus did, and they believed in him. The Gospel of Christ. Hear what these ancient words are saying to us today. And we're going to sing another song, "Breathe on Me, Breath of God."
Thank you.
Let us pray. O Lord, we pray, speak in this place, in the calming of our minds and the longing of our hearts, by the words of my lips and the thoughts that we form. Speak, O Lord, for your servants are listening. There's a story that came out of South Africa several years back. There was a hospital that seemed to have this span of bad luck for some reason. Every Friday morning, that same patient in the same bed would die, regardless of the patient's medical condition. This puzzled the hospital staff. Some were believing there the place was supernatural or it was cursed. Well, doctors decided they had to look into this. They had to do something. So they went down to that ward that Friday morning, and they watched that room like a hawk. Nurses and doctors and staff were all watching that Friday, but nothing happened. Everything seemed normal. It looked like a normal Friday. And then the cleaning crew comes in to do the regular cleaning. And the cleaning crew gets at their work. And then suddenly the staff figured out what the problem was. The cleaning staff was unplugging the life support machine to plug in their vacuum cleaner. I'll bet you thought that was a true story. The scary thing is, that story does have a ring of truth to it. Our readings this morning deal with the unpleasant topic of life and death. Now, we Christians have a love-hate relationship with death, don't we? We have a spiritual schizophrenia, if you want to call it, about that subject. On one hand, we regard death as a great enemy, one that interrupts our lives and our relationship with the people around us. It's the great enemy, one to be feared, the grim reaper, that awful specter that hangs over our lives. We use euphemisms all too often to help us avoid confronting the subject directly. We'll say things like, "She's passed away," or "He's no longer with us." We do anything to avoid saying, "They're dead. They died." It's like a word we talk with great dread. But at the same time, we avoid mentioning death by name. We also make cases that we believe that death is a Christian's friend. When somebody dies, we might say, "She's gone to be with Jesus," or "He's at his eternal rest. No more pain, no more tears, only a world of eternal bliss." And as a Christian, we know that Jesus rose again from the dead. He had to die first on Good Friday, only to rise on Easter Sunday. Well, here we are just 2 weeks away from Easter Sunday, and on that Sunday, our churches are going to be filled with people singing happy songs. "He lives, he lives. Jesus Christ is risen today. The grave, where is thy victory? Death, where is thy sting?" So which is it? Should we look forward to death, or should we cling stubbornly to life? And the answer is yes. In our reading from Ezekiel, God himself says, "O my people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. Then, my people, you will know that I am the Lord. I will put my spirit in you, and you will live. And I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord." To the reader of the Hebrew Bible, this was good news, because in the Old Testament, there is no real heavily developed doctrine for life after death. In the Old Testament, death was literally the end of the road. The reward for a righteous person was literally a long life, but eventually everyone had to die. So it was good news indeed to hear that one day the graves would be open and that the Spirit of God would breathe life into those who had died. It was something new for these people. And then our gospel reading today, the Gospel of John, where we read about the raising of Lazarus, Jesus' friend. Lazarus' sisters, Mary and Martha, couldn't understand why Jesus just didn't come immediately when he heard that Lazarus was sick. Because as they said, if Jesus had been there, he could have healed Jesus. He could have healed Lazarus. Lazarus wouldn't have died. After all, Jesus had a good reputation for healing people by this time. But everyone there had been raised on the Old Testament doctrine that death was the end of the road. Once you died, that was it. There was no coming back. So why in the world did Jesus take his time getting there? Everyone knew that Jesus loved Lazarus. He loved Mary and Martha. But Mary and Martha could not foresee that Jesus had a greater plan in mind. Not only would he restore the brother to them, but Christ would show them that death was not something to be feared any longer. Jesus Christ was the Lord of life and death. Now, both of these stories show that there was a time when there seemed to be no hope, but yet Jesus brings hope. God can bring hope to the most hopeless of situations, even the situation of death. So again, how do we feel about death? Shall we ignore it, deny it, fear it? Or do we embrace it, rejoice in it, look forward to it? Now the testimony of the scriptures tells us that yes, we should love life. Life is God's creation. Life is God's gracious gift to us all. Life is a gift itself. Jesus said himself in John 10:10 that Jesus came that we might have life and life in abundance. Novelist Anna Quinlan was speaking to the graduating class of 1999 in Villanova University. She told him a story about how once she did a story on the homeless and how the homeless people survive in the winter. In the middle of her research, she came upon met this homeless man on the boardwalk on Coney Island. The two of them sat on the wooden supports of the boardwalk and dangled their feet over the wooden supports, and they looked out over the sea. And the homeless man told her about his schedule, of what it was like to panhandle on the boulevard when the summer crowds had gone. He told them of sleeping in the church when the temperature got below freezing. He told them how he played hide-and-seek from the police in the Tilt-A-Whirl or the Cyclone or some of the other carnival rides. But he told her most of the time he spent his time on the boardwalk, facing out to the water, just the way they were sitting there and then, even when it got cold. And Anna asked him, why? Why didn't you go to one of the shelters to stay warm? Why didn't you check yourself into a hospital for detox? And he just stared at the ocean and said, look at the view, young lady, look at the view. Anna ended her speech like this. She said, every day in some little way, I try to do just what he said, to look at the view. And that's the last thing I have to tell you today. The words of wisdom from a man who didn't have a dime to his name, no place to go, nowhere to be. Look at the view and you'll never be disappointed. It's obvious that with all his other problems, that homeless man had a love for life. He had a love for what was around him. And so should we. It is really troubling when I hear somebody say, no, this world would be better off if I weren't around. It isn't the case. We should never say that. And if you ever hear anybody saying that, you should go talk to them because they need help. We are all made for life. And I know life can be hard at times. It can be downright cruel at times. But there is no storm that you or I can go through without, there's no storm that we can pass through with the help of God. God can get us through everything. A failed marriage, loss of a job, rejection at school, the death of a loved one. The world is full of hurt, but it doesn't mean that we can't find any meaning and happiness through it all. With God's help, we can find meaning and hope even in the most hopeless situations. There's a story about Gary Stanley. As a young boy, he came home from school one day to have his father meet him. His father told him that his dog Waddles, his friend for 6 years, had been hit by a car and killed instantly. The father and son, they cried together, and they buried Waddles beneath the apple tree in the backyard. Stanley says he remembers the bits and pieces of his father's wisdom that afternoon. His father said, everything we have is on loan from God. And his father then said, do not bury your heart in the grave of someone you love. Wise words. Do not bury your heart in the grave of someone you love. Do not bury your heart in a failed relationship or discouraging work situation or rejection by your friend or even in the grave of someone you love. Give yourself that second chance. Give God another chance. There is still work for you to do in this world. God still has plans for you if you are still here. That's the reason you're alive. Dr. Diana Klump, a pediatric oncologist, described herself as an agnostic or even an atheist when she first started practicing medicine. But working with dying children, she discovered a faith, an unshakable faith in God. She tells of a time that she came to the realization that God was still here. She tells of a time very early in her career when a 7-year-old Anna had been fighting leukemia for 5 long years. But that little girl had no more strength to fight. Moments before she died, that little girl suddenly sat up in her bed and she announced, I see the angels. And her face lit up with joy as she described the beautiful singing that she heard. And then she lay down and she passed. Mary and Martha thought Jesus had failed them that day. Lazarus had died. Lazarus was in the tomb. But Jesus never fails us. Jesus is always there. He is our best friend. He is always there for us. It may be the hardest thing we ever do is to find and to figure out what God needs us to do after we lose somebody who is so close to us, somebody we love so dearly, someone we love so much. But God tells us there is work for you still to do. This is a feeling many people have when they lose someone they love, especially if that person was young and still had a long life in front of them. It can be hard to see Christ through the grief. It can be hard to find out why. We ask God, why? God, why? But it's times like these, we really need to look hard to find God's presence in it all. Because hard as it is, God is still there for us. There's a great power in our faith, if you but take it to heart. W.P. McKay, a Scottish doctor, who at one time in his early years totally rejected Christianity, just rejected it out of hand, had no belief in it, no use for Christianity. But one time he was treating a poor homeless laborer who was dying from very painful injuries. In spite of the man's pain, he found great peace in reading his Bible. The doctor gave him his Bible, and the man read it. After the man's death, Dr. McKay opened that man's Bible, and imagine his surprise when he saw his name written in that Bible. This was the very Bible that Dr. McKay's mother gave him as a boy. He sold that Bible years before, but it found its way back to him through the hands of a homeless man. Dr. McKay went on to become a Christian that day. He took in Christ, and he would later write a very famous hymn, "Revive Us Again." There is great power in our faith. The same Jesus who called his friend Lazarus from the grave, who called Lazarus from the grave, calls us as friends as well. God will never forget us and never forsake us if we but hold on to that faith. There's a story of great strength and hopelessness, there's great strength and hope in a hopeless situation that comes from the story of Zoe Koplowich. For 15 years, Zoe had multiple sclerosis ruled her life. The disease results in a weakening of the muscles, blurred vision, loss of balance, slurring of speech. Depending on how far it progresses, MS can leave a person paralyzed, blind, unable to speak. And for those 15 years after being diagnosed, Zoe did not push herself very much physically. She's afraid that it would advance the disease quicker. But then one day she just got angry and she decided she was going to fight that disease. The disease that had so controlled her life for 15 years. So she made up her mind she was going to participate in the New York City Marathon, a 26.6-mile run that attracts runners from all over the world. Friends would joke with Zoe that this Zoe, who walked with two canes, might easily be mistaken for Greta Wentz, who had won that race for 8 years in a row. Well, that year, 1988, Greta won her ninth race, the New York City Marathon, with a time of 2 hours and 25 minutes. Zoe came in struggling dead last that evening at 20 hours of walking. For the next 5 years, Zoe participated in that marathon year after year. In 1993, Greta and Zoe actually met at a dinner in Greta's honor. The famed marathon run was in awe of this woman who pushed herself to compete in a race despite her disabilities. Trying to understand Zoe's motivation, Greta asked, "Who's waiting for you at the finish line?" As that world-renowned runner, Greta always had people that mattered, fans, newspaper reporters that wanted to cheer her on. They were always waiting for her at the end of the line. By the time Zoe finished the race, everyone had gone home. But that day, Greta promised Zoe that she would be at the end of that finish line for her the next time she raced. Now, a number of health problems hit Zoe that year. It took her 28 hours to finish the race that year. But Greta was waiting for her there to cross that finish line. Now, sadly, somebody had went home with all the finisher's medals. So Greta learned that Zoe wouldn't get a medal for her efforts in running that race. So before Zoe crossed the finish line, she ran across town, asked her husband to give up his own medal that he won that day, and she came back in time to cheer Zoe as she crossed the finish line, and she put that medal around her neck. And every year since, Greta has waited at the finish line for Zoe. The two women have become good friends, and they speak at various school events throughout the city, where they teach children the valuable lesson about a winning spirit. Do you know who's waiting for you at the finish line? the same one who has sustained your life throughout all your days, the one who wants to be your friend in everything. Don't ever think about dropping out of that race. Embrace life. It is God's goodwill for us all. Embrace life. Death is not the end of the race. It's just a new beginning. Amen. Let's continue with a prayer of thanksgiving. We give you all thanks and praise, O God, for yours is the power of life that even death cannot hold back. You created the world and breathed your spirit into our bodies of earth, forming for yourself a people with whom to celebrate life. In Jesus Christ, your child, you have sent us one who is both death, both life and resurrection. Sharing our grief in the face of death, he prized open the grip of the grave and called us forth into the fullness of life and peace. Arousing the fury of hell, he was crucified and cast lifeless into its depths. But you raised him to a new life. Now whenever people lay lost in the valley of death, he again comes speaking the word of life and calling his spirit to breathe new life into us so that hope is reborn and you are glorified. Therefore, with our hearts lifted high, we offer you thanks and praises at all times through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. God is more than ready to hear our prayers than we are to speak them. Let us pray for other people. Source of life, God of love, let your salvation surround the living who walk under the shadow of death, and the dead who are gloriously alive. Great spirit friend,
come with your life and light.
Be close to your dying children. By simple faith in your undying grace, may they have peace in their hour of their departing. Great spirit friend,
come with your life and light.
Be close to people who are caught up in the rawness of new grief. Enable them to weep well, free from the bitterness or despair. Great spirit friend,
come with your life and light.
Be close to all who care for the dying, in hospitals, at home, or in hospitals, on the battlefield. Give them a quiet strength. Great spirit friend,
come with your life and light.
Be close to your ministers, priests, and lay pastors who pray with the dying. Ministers who minister the last rites or sit holding the hand. Great spirit friend,
come with your life and light.
Be close to those who fight against untimely death, those who spend their days working for the elimination of cancer, AIDS, and many other diseases, the carnage on our highways and the butchery of warfare. Great spirit friend,
come with your life and light.
Be close to the preachers of the gospel of peace. Be by your tireless spirit, may inadequate words take flesh and become powerful agents in helping people to begin living life eternal now.
Jesus, our Lord. Amen.
And now I invite you all to join in the prayer that Jesus taught us as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name,
thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
the power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now we'll say a prayer over the blessing, over the giving offerings that you left on your way in. Let us pray together. Spirit of life, we breathe our lives on these gifts, that they may become a fertile plain of green life and strength and hope for all who live in the valley of dry bones. May the wind of your love carry these gifts far beyond us to the places most in need of your compassionate grace.
We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
And our closing hymn this morning is "Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing." And now, that peace that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge of God's total and inclusive love, shown to us when he sent his son Jesus to show us that life does continue, that the resurrection is always there for us. And after 2,000 years, people are still being saved by this man. And the blessing of God, the creator, the sustainer, and the redeemer, be with you all and remain with you always. Amen. And now, that peace that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge of God's total and inclusive love, shown to us when he sent his son Jesus to show us that life does continue, that the resurrection is always there for us. And after 2,000 years, people are still being saved by this man. And the blessing of God, the creator, the sustainer, and the redeemer, be with you all and remain with you always. Amen. And now, that peace that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge of God's total and inclusive love, shown to us when he sent his son Jesus to show us